Okay, we are good to go. Take it away.
Everyone's watching? Okay, hi everybody. Welcome to Calgary 911. Thanks for having us in your class today. I know we're really far away and we're really small up here, so sorry about that. My name is Betty. I am an emergency officer.
My name is Heather, and I'm also an emergency communications officer.
So we have a presentation for you today. We are going to go through what happens when you call 911 and why you would call 911.
And this presentation works really well if you ask questions.
Indeed.
Yeah, so ask any questions that you want to know about 911.
Absolutely. We cannot wait for those questions at the end. That would be awesome. Okay, so our first slide, we use an acronym called PSAP. That stands for Public Safety Answering Point. So the different colors that you see on the map are the different areas, different PSAPs all over the province. That is called, the Public Safety Answering Point. There are 21 of these in the province of Alberta. And depending on where you're calling from, your phone will connect you to one of these centers.
And you never have to remember this because your cell phone is super smart and will go to the right one. And if it's not the right one, we can get you to the right one.
Absolutely.
Okay, so this is the area that Calgary 911 answers for. We answer calls for people who are in places like Cochrane, Chestermere, and Canmore. If you're out for a hike in Kananaskis and you need help, we will answer your call. We answer over 1 million calls a year, and we're the largest dispatch center in Alberta, serving the most amount of communities. That number of calls has stayed pretty consistent with the population. So when Calgary had 600,000 people, we took roughly 600,000 calls a year. We're now, I think we're up to 1.4 million, something like that. We take about 1.4 million calls a year.
So these are some of our coworkers. We wear a uniform and we work in a dispatch center all together. We are the first responders. So we will make sure that we send the right people to the right emergencies.
Okay, and we work 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Mm-hmm. So we work Christmas, we work Ramadan, we even work on my birthday. Okay, so we never have a day when we're not working.
All right, so the biggest organizations that we dispatch for include the fire department, the Calgary Police Service, and bylaw services. That includes transit and animal officers.
And we have about 60 people on any given day. We have a lot more during Stampede. Halloween is a very busy night for us. Our busiest night is New Year's Eve. Second is Halloween. But we also work Hanukkah, Ramadan, Diwali, New Year's Day, Easter, Thanksgiving, all of those special days that you're with your family. We have people who leave their families and come here to be ready for whatever emergency we have.
Indeed. Our ECOs, which we call our emergency communications officers, can speak several different languages on the floor. And we also have access to a translation line that offers more than 200 languages. So if your family or friends speak a different language at home, encourage them to learn their address in English and to let the call taker know what language they speak. So our first question for you in our Q&A chat there, how many of you speak another language at home? And I want you to put the language that you speak in the chat so we can look at it later, okay?
It's really important that everyone knows it's safe to call 911. We want to make sure that people know that it doesn't matter if they speak English, we can get them help, even if their English is not very good or there's no English at all. Okay, knowing your address is very helpful. After that, we can help you.
Okay, so let's talk about when to call 911 for the fire department. So there's obvious reasons why you would call the fire department. You see a house or a building on fire, you see a grass fire outside, that kind of thing. You know, of course you call the fire department for that. So some other reasons that you might call them that you might not know about, your smoke or carbon monoxide detector is going on in your house And you don't know why. You don't smell anything. You don't see anything. You're just really not sure why. Please feel free to call the fire department because they will be happy to come and check your alarms for you. They will come and help you if you're stuck in an elevator or say you're rafting on the river and you get stuck on a rock or under a bridge. They do water rescues all spring and summer long. And it's okay if you see a car accident and you're not really sure what's going on. If you're not sure whether to call about something, that's okay. Just tell the call taker what's happening and they will make sure they're sending the appropriate question. All right. So how, and again, in the chat, in our question and answer, have any of you ever heard your fire alarm going off in your house? I know you've all heard it in school because we all have fire drills. But have any of you ever heard it go off in your house or in a different public building, something like that? You can tell us about that.
All right. Okay, so these are some of the reasons that you would call for the police department. If there's a crime in progress, right, like a theft or, you know, something violent is happening, people are fighting, you can call anytime. Maybe you see somebody elderly who looks lost or a child who looks lost. We would encourage you to call for anything that's suspicious. So what is suspicious? Suspicious is anything that looks out of place to you. Okay, so we don't judge. If you think it looks suspicious, then we're going to send the police out to check it out. If it turns out to be nothing, that's great. It's 5 minutes out of the officer's day and we'll be on our way. But if you aren't sure if it's an emergency, definitely call us on 911. And a lot of times people try to think, okay, should I call the non-emergency number? And the non-emergency number is 403-266-1234. So it's great when you have, when you know it's a non-emergency, you can call that. But if you're not sure, call 911. Because Betty and I answer both lines. And the only difference between non-emerge and emerge is that the 911 calls come in first. Okay, so that's the only difference. So what we really want is for you to call. Don't be afraid.
So did you guys know that there's a school resource officer assigned to every single school in the city? They're the ones that will come and help you with your practice lockdowns, things like that. They'll come and help you with other issues. So if you don't know who your school resource officer is, definitely maybe find that out and see if they can come for a visit in your school so you guys can all meet them. They would be happy to do that. All right. And when to call for an ambulance. So the ambulance is the third big emergency service that we dispatch for. We don't have any EMS call takers with us anymore, but we'll talk about reasons for you guys when you're going to call an ambulance. And I know that one of your other presentations is a tour of the ambulance. I wish I could go to that.
Oh, super cool.
Sounds amazing. All right. So the reasons you call an ambulance for medical emergencies. Some of the big things are breathing problems or chest pain, or if you see somebody bleeding quite badly, or some fainting. So the call taker at EMS can actually give you life-saving instructions while you're waiting for the ambulance. So make sure that you stay on the line with them if you have to call them.
Is it faster for you to drive to the hospital or to get an ambulance, Betty? Because sometimes it's hard to wait, right? You think, I don't want to wait for an ambulance.
It really depends on the situation. If you think that you can wait until you get to the hospital and someone can drive you, great.
But if you're in doubt, call 911. Mm-hmm. Okay, so the first question we ask you when you call 911 is, 911, what is your emergency? And that is so we can ensure that you get the right help that you need. Betty and I get lots of special training. So if you don't know what you need, that's okay. You just tell us what the problem is and we will help you. Okay, the next question that we ask is the most important question we ask, and that is, what is your address? What is the location of the emergency? If we don't know where you are, we can't send help. So it's really important to know where you are. So call us, even if you're scared or you're not sure, we're going to help you work through. Okay, so maybe you're at your friend's house and you don't know the address. We can help you with that. Or you're not sure which street you're on because the problem's outside. So it's really important that you know your own address. Okay, so if you haven't memorized your own address, make sure you do that today.
Mm-hmm. Indeed. Okay, so addresses can be all kinds of things depending on where you are. Maybe you're at home and you can give us your home address. Maybe you're at school. The name of the school is enough information for us to locate you. If you're calling from a landline, like at a house or a business, the kind of phone that plugs into the wall somewhere, which is very rare these days, but they still exist, we can get that exact address from the line that you're calling from. All right. I don't know. Does anyone out there still have a landline at home? Because I don't.
Do you?
I do have a landline.
Yeah, most people have cell phones these days, but I love my landline. It's a good deal.
Excellent. All right. Now we'll talk about cell phones.
Okay, so if you're calling from a cell phone, the technology is getting better and better, but it's not like on TV, okay? So we're only going to have a rough idea of where you might be, so we're going to ask you more questions about your location. So you need to try and be patient with us. Your cell phone gets signals from the three nearest cell phone towers, and then it tells us the best guess of where you might be in that area. We want to make sure that that information matches with where the emergency is happening. So we need to ask you a lot of questions, and depending on the amount of cell phone traffic, sometimes your signal bounces off of a cell tower that's farther away, and so the accuracy will be less accurate, and we're not going to know if it's going to be more accurate or less accurate. So we really need you to stay on the line with us and listen to our questions.
All right, so this one's animated, guys. Bear with me. I hope this works.
Just click this. Yeah, if you can see a landmark like the Calgary Tower, click.
Oh, look at that. I clicked it. I did it, guys. Woohoo!
Yay!
All right, so if you can see, we can go by landmarks. If you can see a landmark like the Calgary Tower, the Olympic Oval, that's also enough information for us to get started and get help on the way.
Please don't say you're at the Tim Hortons.
Yeah, the Tim Hortons won't really help because there's so many. All right. Another way is we may ask you to go to the end of the block and read us the street signs. If you can even spell them out to us, that would be great. If you don't really know what they say or how to pronounce them, that's absolutely fine. If you were at the park, for example, something you may not know or be aware of is all of our pathways in Calgary have these bright yellow location signs. So it usually starts with one or two letters and then a dash and then three numbers. If you read us the letter and number combination, we can actually find you right away. So please, if you're out walking with your family or your friends on these pathways, make sure you point out those signs. They're really, really bright, and say, hey, did you know that if you have an emergency, you can give the 911 call taker these letters and they can find you exactly where you are. And it's true, our maps point to exactly where these signs are on the pathways. So they're absolutely great.
Okay, so knowing your home address and phone number is really important. So put them in a place that's easy to see, like the fridge or a bulletin board. Now, you probably know your home address and phone number, but your babysitter might not, grandma might not, and your friends might not. So if you put your address and phone number on a piece of paper on the fridge, then everybody can see what it is, okay? And that just helps us find you even faster. Now, even if we're having trouble finding you, we don't give up, okay? We will keep looking until we find you, but we want to get help to you as soon as possible. So having that address on the fridge, very helpful.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so we're going to have some fun. Me and Heather are going to do a phone call of somebody calling the police on 911. So we're going to kind of show you how fast a phone call can go and what information that we're looking for, okay? Heather's going to be the call taker and I'm going to be the caller.
Okay, so 911, what is your emergency?
I've been in a car accident.
Oh no! Okay, what town or city are you in?
I'm in Calgary.
Stay on the line for Calgary Police. We wait for just a second. And then, Calgary Police, what is the address of your emergency?
Oh, I'm not really sure, but I'm in the parking lot at Telus Park.
Okay, where exactly are you at Telus Park?
I can see the playground, and we're kind of parked by there.
Okay, what is your phone number?
403-566-4321.
Great job. And what is your name?
My name is Han Solo.
Han Solo? Okay. Tell me exactly what happened, Han Solo.
Well, I was backing out of my parking spot and I hit the side of another car that was driving by.
Is anyone injured?
Nope, we're all fine and we're all out walking around.
Great. Are your airbags deployed?
Nope, they're still intact.
How many vehicles are involved?
There's two of us.
Okay, I need to get a description of the vehicles on scene.
Okay, well, I'm driving a blue Volkswagen camper van, and the other vehicle is a white minivan.
Okay, what is your license plate?
F-A-L-C-O-N.
A great license plate, Han Solo. Can you see the other license plate?
You know what? I outside of the car, and I don't really feel comfortable getting out of the van.
That's okay. Help is on the way. I already have a call-up for the police to attend. If the vehicle is causing danger and it's safe to do so, move it to a safer location. So out of the flow of traffic or off to the side of the roadway. For everyone's safety, tell any bystanders to stand well clear of approaching traffic. And if it's safe to do so, turn on your flashing hazard lights. Without putting yourself in any danger, have your driver's license, vehicle registration, and insurance paperwork ready for the officers. An officer will be dispatched as soon as possible. Call us back if anything changes.
Okay, thank you very much.
Great. Help is on the way.
That's it. That's the whole call. So it goes pretty fast. Okay.
So after we have gathered all of the information for the police, fire, ambulance, we're going to have some instructions for you. And you just heard me reading some of the instructions, so we might ask you to stay off the roadway, to put on your hazard lights, to put any pets away, unlock your door, things like that. Those are things that you would think of normally, but when you're in a stressful situation, you're probably going to forget. We do ask you to put away any pets, even if the pets are friendly, because sometimes they get a little bit agitated with the first responders and then they might get distracted. Okay, and then we'll have some instructions as well to help you stay safe or get to safety. We are a team. 911 is definitely a team sport. We are always working together to help in an emergency, and you can help us do some really important jobs before help arrives that can save somebody's life, no matter how old you are.
Indeed. All right, so accidental calls to 911. If you do dial by mistake, that's okay. We get lots of accidental dials in a day, especially with the Apple Watches. People always call us with the Apple Watches since they started becoming popular. It is totally okay. We understand that it happens. Just make sure that you stay on the line with the call taker. The call taker just needs to ask you a couple questions and make sure that everyone's safe, and then they'll let you go. You're not in trouble or anything. It happens. It's all good. So it really helps us out if you just stay on the line and say, oh, I'm sorry, that was an accidental dial.
Okay, and it's okay to feel scared or sad or even to not be sure how you're feeling. It can be very scary when somebody's having an emergency and you need to call 911, but the trusted adult on the other end of the phone is there to help you and help make sure that the police, fire, ambulance gets to the emergency. We're going to ask you lots of questions. We're going to ask you so many questions. You're going to be like, could you just please send help and stop asking questions? But remember that help is on the way almost right away, okay? Almost immediately. And those questions are helping them respond in the right way and send the right fire truck or send the right number of police cars, okay? And so we'll ask you all these questions. It's okay if you don't know the answer. We just ask because we can't see you, so we can't see the situation. We're going to do the best we can to understand the situation, and if you don't know, that's okay. We deal with calls to 911 every day. Your worst day is our work day.
Absolutely. Okay, our motto, we are everyone's 911, and we want to introduce you to our mascot, Echo. He was there helping out that day. So no matter your age, gender, ethnicity, background, we are everyone's 911, and we are always here to help. So that's kind of our presentation about what to expect when you call 911. And now we want to kind of get into our fun stuff. So we love getting out in the community. We love building community. We really, really missed everybody during COVID, and we couldn't wait to see you again. We absolutely love our Calgary community. We attend lots of public events so that we can create a safe city where you can live, love, and play and be free to do so. So you'll see us at events like the Pride Parade in September. And there's Echo in the background there. They love to go to the parade. Absolutely. It's their favorite day of the year, I think.
Yeah, I think so.
Has anyone ever met an ECO or Echo at an event before? We want to hear from you in our Q&A, okay? All right. I'll do this with you. So this is another program we have. It's called The Crime Not to Read. Our ECOs partner up with our police officers, and they go to classrooms and read books, and they love to do it. They absolutely love to see you guys face-to-face, because really, we don't get to see many of you, right? We're always on the phone. So anytime we can see you guys in person, that is amazing. So here's our friend Caitlin reading a book to our class there. So fun. So if you guys have that program in your school, also, we want to hear about it.
Okay, on Tim Hortons Camp Day, we get to have a field trip and we hand out coffees at Tim's. And that's Jamie handing out an ice cap. Ice caps are delicious.
Yep,
they sure are. So we try to get out and just show you a friendly face.
Indeed. And then there's Echo helping out on Tim Hortons Camp Day too. They will never miss a chance to go to Tim's. Like, if Echo isn't at their desk taking calls, sometimes they have to run across the street to Tim's to bring them back.
Coffee right. is really important.
Yeah, just total addict. So, yeah. Okay, so, and we want to hear from you. Who here likes Tim Hortons, okay? Because that's a really important question. It really is.
Okay, and another field trip day we get to go on is the Military and First Responders Day at Stampede. We do love pancakes. I can tell you that, I enjoy the occasional pancake.
Do you see a trend here? We really like food.
Yeah, we do really like food.
We do love food here. So, yeah, we love celebrating Stampede. And getting out there in person. And this is our honor guard. So our honor guard gets invited to things like the Flames games, and they get to carry the flags, and they get to go out with the person that sings the national anthem. And then they also can attend other really important events as well. So it's really neat to see them.
And that we can also talk to emergency responders all over the world. So sometimes loved ones might need help in another country. You can dial 911 in Calgary, and we will make sure you get in contact with the right services where you where your loved ones are. So if you're on a FaceTime call with grandma and grandpa, and one of them needs help, you can call us to send them help. So I can tell you an actual story about a time when a man was talking to his grandpa in, I think it was Sweden. I'm not sure, I can't remember. Oslo, that's right, it was Oslo in Norway. And he was talking, and grandpa had a stroke on FaceTime while his grandson was talking to him. And so when you call 911 in Calgary, you can only talk to 911 in Calgary. You can't call 911 in Oslo. We don't have that ability. So he phoned and we said, no problem, let us help you. So we were able to get in touch with the consulate, right? So the diplomats that work in Oslo, and we said, hey, can you help us? And can you call 911 for us? And they did. And they sent the paramedics out to grandpa's house in Oslo. And he could see the paramedics coming in through the door to help his grandpa who had a stroke. So we could do some pretty amazing things. So if you ever need help and you think, a very weird situation. That's okay. We probably do.
We're used to it.
Yeah, we're experts in weird, okay? So give us a call.
For sure. All right. So this is our last slide, guys. Once again, we are everyone's 911. We love being out in the community. We're here if you need us. That is it. That's it for our presentation. And now we want to talk to you guys. Hi, Carrie.
Hi. Awesome. So there's some questions in the chat.
Excellent. I can't wait.
Yeah. So it might take a couple minutes for some of the other ones to come in if folks are currently typing them in. But the ones that we have right now, for your awareness, we have Ms. Rankin's grade 5 class, our linguistic heroes. They have a bunch of different languages in their class. I apologize if I don't pronounce some of these correctly. Some of the words aren't familiar to me, actually. So Tigirnya, T-I-G-I-R-N-Y-A, Nepali.
I have actually brought on translators for Tigrinya more than once.
Perfect.
Absolutely. Oh, awesome.
Nepali.
Yep.
Punjabi, Fascia, Spanish, Arabic, Urdu, and Amharic. Yeah.
I've heard that one. How do you spell it?
Yeah. A-M-H-A-R-I-C.
Amharic. It's Ethiopian.
Oh, yes. Very okay. Cool. Amharic. Okay. Awesome. I'd really like to learn about all the different languages out there. Excellent.
And then we had some questions. So what happens if you call 911 but get disconnected before you can give them the address?
We call you right back.
We do.
Perfect.
Your phone number, hopefully it's not an anonymous, like it sometimes people block their phone numbers to show up on call display. But most of the time phone numbers that call in will show up on call display, and we will make sure we call you right back. If we can't get in touch with you, we're sending a police officer
to your location. If you call 911 from your cell phone, even if we don't have a perfect location, we have an idea of where you are. So we're going to send an officer out to go take a look, see if they can find you.
Yeah.
So best thing is to stay on the phone and answer questions, but that doesn't always happen, right? Sometimes we accidentally hang up or something happens. We don't, but you might. And if that happens, that's okay. You can call us back, and we're going to try and call you back as well.
Mm-hmm. Fantastic. What if you can't speak or hear and you need to call?
So if you call and we don't hear anything, we may ask you questions like, if you can hear me, can you tap on the phone? Or what we can do, we do have the technology to start a text conversation with you. If we feel that there's still an open line and it's quiet, but we kind of hear something and we just don't know what's going on, we will try to text you. And then once again, when we don't really know what's going on, we're sending a police officer right away just to check on you. Yes, we will try everything. Absolutely everything. So, we have lots of creative ways to try to figure out what's happening there.
Awesome. How long do people on the phones train for? So our dispatchers.
So right now we train for 9 weeks, and that's in the classroom. And then we also practice taking calls. And then we have another 3 weeks at least where they're sitting taking calls with a coach. And the coach makes sure that they're doing everything correctly. And once they are doing everything correctly, then the coach says, okay, and signs them off. And then they're allowed to be by themselves.
Mm-hmm. And if you speak Persian language, we would love to have you work for us.
We sure would, yeah.
Awesome. So can the emergency call center call for any spot in the entire world?
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah, it's not, like, honestly, it would take a couple of minutes to some places, but we would do our best. We have a lot of resources and we're very creative people. Mm-hmm. We're problem solvers. So if you give us a problem that we haven't seen before, we're gonna help you with it regardless. The other thing is we're in a really big room. So we're not in little offices. We're all in one big room together. So Betty and I never just sit by ourselves. We're always together, ready to help each other. So if I don't know what to do, I can ask Betty and she's going to help me.
Yeah.
Amazing. How did the emergency services get the 911 number?
Oh,
that's a great question.
Okay, so it used to be 999, or it started being 999, but this is taking us back a long way. So there was an old style phone called a rotary phone, and you would have to turn it and let it click back. And 999 takes a long time. So you'd have to be 9, 8, 9, wait, 9, and that's just not going to work, right? So we just do the 9 and then the 1-1. And we kept it once we got push button phones because the 9 and the 1 are not together. And so it makes it easier for people to type.
Indeed. It used to be before the 911 number. I know this happened in the U.S. I'm not really sure what the history is in Canada, but in the U.S. in the big cities like New York, Philadelphia, Los Angeles, what they had a phone box at the end of the street.
Yeah.
and there's quite a few of them, and you would have to run down to the end of your block to this phone box. And when you picked up the phone, it would connect you right to a 911 operator. Now, keep in mind, the person at the other end of the phone didn't exactly have GPS or internet back then either. So if you didn't quite know where you were, they had to do a little bit more sorting out there. So it was a very interesting time for sure. So imagine, oh no, you know, my neighbor's house is on fire. I got to jog two blocks down to the end of the road to get to the emergency call box. But yeah, that was kind of how it used to be before everybody could call right from inside their house. Yeah, it was a lot of changes. We have come a long, long way.
Awesome. Crazy story. Thanks, ladies. Okay, we got some more questions coming in. So what do you suggest if you have no reception and need help?
Oh, yeah, and we get that a lot from our national park, like the provincial parks like Kananaskis and stuff. I know that towards the north, like in the Wypress area, where a lot of people go hunting and fishing, and they take a lot of ATVs up there, the cell phone reception up there is very sketchy. So sometimes people have to drive further down that highway until they get cell phone reception. We've had that before. Sometimes people who are really good at being at backcountry camping, that kind of thing, they have radio or satellite phones with them. Mm-hmm. And they also have, sometimes they have walkie-talkies with certain people. So as soon as you call 911, then what we do is we bring on Kananaskis Emergency Services. They are the absolute experts in backcountry rescues and things like that. They're the ones that, you know, will lift up an injured person from a helicopter, that kind of thing. They're amazing. So we will bring them on. If we get a really good GPS coordinates on your phone, we will give them the GPS coordinates, and then they will take it from there. And then we will get our fire trucks in Canmore and down in Kananaskis. They'll get ready to go as soon as we tell them to. So we have quite the amazing operation out there in the mountains. It's pretty, pretty amazing. But yeah, unfortunately, sometimes cell phone service is sketchy. So you may have to just move or see if somebody else has a radio or satellite phone, that kind of thing. Yeah.
Awesome. Thank you. Yeah. When I do backcountry camping, I always bring a satellite phone for that reason. So. Awesome. So if somebody faints on a phone call, but they are across an ocean, how do you know to help them?
Across an ocean?
Mm-hmm.
They faint and they're across the ocean?
So they're in a different country? Is that what you mean?
Yeah, I think so. Or perhaps like, say, if somebody's on the phone with their grandparents and they're visiting somewhere in Hawaii and they think they might have fainted.
Usually when you have family members traveling, the safe thing to do is to tell your family members here where exactly you're staying, the name of the hotel or the address of the house that you're renting.
Yeah, yeah, that would be it. So if you're phoning in Calgary about somewhere else, we would need to know something, right? Like a city, street, address, we would need to know a little bit of information. And then we would work with the first responders in that area to try and find where that person is. The more information you have, the faster the response is, right? So we can kind of work miracles. I'm kind of astounded sometimes at the things that we're able to do, but it always works better when the caller has the information to begin with, because then we're not slowed down at all.
Does this work for if folks have, sometimes people have a bracelet or a necklace if they fall down, that alerts either, generates an alert somehow? Would something like that help as well?
Yeah. So some people wear medical or bracelets, or they'll wear the alert around their neck. So what happens is those things can detect falls. Mm-hmm. And that goes to, they pay every month to be a subscriber to this service. It's kind of like a house alarm. So if your burglary alarm's going off, say it's like TELUS or what are some other alarm companies that we work with? It'll be Medic Alert. So they're different companies, they're private companies, and they offer this service and say, and they will call us directly. They actually have a direct backdoor line to 911. They will say, tell us what kind of alarm. It's a medical alarm. We received a fall alarm, and this is the name of the client, and this is their address. Or we received a burglary alarm. It seems that there's a window that's broken at this address. Sometimes the iPhones and the iWatches have new alerts. We get a lot of crash alarms from iPhones. And unfortunately, it's not perfect. Sometimes ladies will have their purse in their, or their phone in their purse, and they'll set their purse down really hard, and we get a crash alarm. So it's, you know, there's still some kinks that we need to work out, but at least we're calling them saying, hey, we received this alert from your phone, and they'll say, oh my gosh, I'm sorry, I'm fine, I just, you know, did whatever. So we have a lot of really new technology coming up in the next year or two. It's going to be changing a huge amount. So there's going to be more options. I'm hoping in the future, we will have some kind of way that people can just send us a text and we'll be alerted to it, because right now we don't have that in place, but hopefully in the future we will.
Yeah, that is definitely coming.
Yep, indeed. And hopefully
fantastic.
We keep up.
I'm sure you folks can. You sound very adaptable. Okay, so we have two more questions. So if you're, for example, in another city and you accidentally contact Canada instead of the local 911 dispatch where you are, how do they connect you to the right area?
So you can't call accidentally the wrong 911 agency. You can only call 911 for the area that you're in. Mm-hmm. Okay, so your cell phone figures it out. So that's great, because if you're driving across Canada and you have a car accident in Saskatchewan, you're going to get Saskatchewan 911, the area mm-hmm. that you're in. But if for some reason, like in Calgary, we have a different agency that answers for Airdrie, for example, or Okotoks if you need the RCMP. So if your cell phone's on the border, it could come through to the wrong 911 center, but that's no big deal, because when they pick up the phone and say, where are you, what's happening, and you say you're in Airdrie, they say no problem, we'll get you to the right spot, mm-hmm. or Red Deer or wherever.
So during Stampede, we have thousands of visitors to the city. So our call volume is even twice as much as it usually is. A lot of times people are visitors. They're like, I don't know where I am. I don't know the city. I've only been here a day. But they are using their own cell phones that they brought with them, and they've called 911, and they will get us because they're here in Calgary.
And we will have a pretty good location for the cell phone. It can vary, like I said, depending on how much traffic there is, but we'll at least have an idea of where that person is.
Mm-hmm. Amazing.
We'll say, hey, what do you see around you? Do you see the name of a business? Do you see a house number? We'll always ask them what they
see
around.
You see lots of people in check shirts and cowboy boots? Sure. We know exactly where you are.
Fantastic. Okay, so our last question is, if there is a bad guy in the house and the bad guy has the phone, how else can you get help?
Well, the best thing to do is try and get out of the house, right? That's really important. That's the best thing. Just run. But if you can't and you don't have a phone, you should hide.
Yeah.
Right? That's the second best thing to do. But the very best thing, just leave the house. Go to a neighbor's, run down the street.
Yeah. Take yourself away or hide. Eventually, like, it might take a bit before somebody calls us, but eventually we're going to get there for sure. But you need to make sure that you keep yourself safe.
And so given that we're talking to kids, this is a good thing to know, that there's not just mom and dad's cell phone. Because if mom and dad leave the house and they are the only ones with a phone, there's now no phone in the house. Right? So that might be a good safety conversation to have at home. Like, what would I do if there was a fire and mom and dad are gone, right? They ran to the store or something like that. So always make sure you have access to a way to call either a landline or an emergency cell phone in the house.
We get lots of calls from friends and family saying, I just received this message from So, and they're asking me to call an ambulance or call police. And they've received messages on media, like it's a Facebook message or Instagram or WhatsApp or whatever. If you have a way of messaging any family or friends, any way at all, just say, I'm in trouble. Can you please call 911? And then even if we don't know what's going on, we're still on the way. You know, we've got our lights going on.
Best thing is for you to call us directly. That's the number one thing. That's the fastest way. But like Betty said, if you don't have a phone, but maybe you have the ability to go on Facebook or Instagram and post, you can do that. And we do get calls like that.
Yep. Amazing. Indeed. Awesome. I don't see, just double check our live chat. I don't see any other questions. But I have a quick question for each of you. What is your silliest phone call that you've ever received?
Oh boy, I love this question. This is my favorite. Yes, I was going to tell you this anyway. So one day late at night, it was probably about 1 or 2 in the morning, very, very quiet night. I get a call from a lovely gentleman who is driving downtown. Yes, he called 911 and he said, you know, I don't have an emergency. I just wanted to tell you what happened. I was like, okay, what happened? And he said, well, I was driving down 8th Avenue and a meatball fell on my windshield. And there's a bit of a beat there with me because I was like, oh, so where he's driving, of course, there's a lot of really tall apartment buildings and really tall office buildings. So I was like, okay, well, so somebody maybe threw food off their balcony or something. He goes, yeah, I think that's what happened. I just wanted you to know, and I wanted the other police cars in the area to know so they can watch out for falling meatballs. So I was like, okay, well, I said, is your windshield cracked or anything? He goes, nope, it's fine. I just wanted to let you guys know. And I was like, okay, well, thank you very much. Guys, I got to tell you, I missed a prime opportunity. I should have asked if it was cloudy, right? I should have asked if it was cloudy and maybe there is a chance of meatballs. I missed it. And my coworker, when I told my coworker this call afterwards, they said I should have said that. I was like, oh, what was I thinking? I should have asked that. And then my coworker started asking me, well, what was the meatball like? Was it a hard meatball, like an honest bounce? Or was it a saucy meatball? Did it do splat? So they said I missed all the important questions.
Yeah.
So I was then faced with the fact that I had to send a message out to, so downtown is called District 1 for police. So I had to send out a message to all the District 1 police cars. So what we can do is we can actually type messages and it comes right up to on their screens in their cars. I had to say, well, I guess you have to watch for falling meatballs on 8th Avenue and 1st Street.
Be careful.
I swear I'm not making this up. And then I had to deal with a whole bunch of puns and jokes coming back from our police officers because most of them are just goofy goobers. And they love to joke around. So, yeah. And to this day, that's still probably the silliest call I ever had.
Okay, yeah. I'm trying to think. I don't know if I could go as silliest because I probably got a top 10 list.
Oh.
But I will tell you one of my favorite calls that I tell in presentation.
Okay.
So I had a lady phone one time. This is many years ago. And she said, you know, I have these handcuffs in my house. And I was just like playing around with these handcuffs. And I accidentally handcuffed myself to my cat. And I said, what? And she said, yeah, I was playing with these handcuffs and I handcuffed myself to my cat. And so what she had done was she handcuffed herself around the wrist and the cat around the neck.
Oh dear.
So now I'm thinking this is an emergency for the cat. Like I'm very concerned about this.
Yeah.
So she didn't have any keys for the handcuffs. She had no way to get the handcuffs off. So we sent the fire department to help her lights and sirens because they do enjoy their lights and sirens. And they went out to help rescue mostly that cat. So hopefully she does not play around with handcuffs anymore. So there's never an end to the craziness that people will do to each other and to themselves. So,
indeed.
Yeah.
Indeed.
Those were fantastic stories, ladies. I did not see the meatball coming or the handcuffs.
That is one of the best parts about this job, because you think you've heard it all, but you never have.
No, never have. Not in 7 years. I still get surprised at least once a week.
Yeah.
Awesome. Well, we've got about 15 minutes left. I don't have any remaining questions. So before we go, though, because it looks like perhaps we're going to wrap up the day one a little bit early, is there any nuggets of wisdom that you ladies would love to share with our classrooms today about safety and belonging through 911 dispatch?
I think we kind of covered it, mostly knowing your location. And then just taking a deep breath and listening to us, because we're a team, right? And once you call us, you're on our team, and we're going to work with you and help you get whatever help you need. Mm-hmm. Okay? Whatever crazy situation you're in, we're here to help you with it.
Yeah. Nothing will shock us, I promise you. And if it does shock us, we're not going to show it.
No.
You guys are so adaptable.
We're just going to go with it. But the most important thing is knowing your location.
Yeah. Fantastic.
And they come work for us because we're always hiring. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people, when you're growing up, you think, I want to be a police officer or a firefighter. And they're like super glamorous. But our job is really fun. I've been doing this job for 26 years. I've never been bored. It's a really great job. You just need to be able to type 35 words a minute and then do some testing to see if you're suitable. And if you are somebody that can stay calm during an emergency, we would like to hear from you. So when you get older, think about us as our career, because it's a really great job. It's a fun job.
Awesome. Indeed. So if any of y'all hear the call to join the 911 team, unintended, and you have linguistic skills and you're empathetic and you're good in a crisis, it sounds like you got a cool team waiting for you.
Yeah, for sure. We'd love to hear from you.
Mm-hmm. Okay, awesome. Well, thank you so much, ladies, for your time today. Did you want to say a send off to the classroom?
Thank you so much for having us. Great questions.
Thank you.
Absolutely. You guys are awesome. And so you are our first one. So thanks for letting us be letting us do our first run through with you. I hope you enjoyed it.
Okay, awesome. Thank you, everybody. This concludes day one of the Safety Expo. We will see you all back here tomorrow. Have a great day.
Okay, bye guys.
Bye. Bye.